Welcome back to our study in Luke. We've looked at the first three chapters of Luke, and now today we're going to look at Luke chapter 6. Last week in Luke chapter 3, we looked at the preaching of John the Baptist. And John said that we have to bear fruits of repentance. And as we looked at that, what he was primarily saying is, if you truly repent, it's going to show up in the way that you treat other people. Here in chapter 6, Jesus picks up on that theme and takes it even further. Again, he says a lot of our faith is worked out in the way that we treat others. But he goes even further. He compares the way that we need to treat one another to the way that God has treated us. God has given us unconditional love, unconditional mercy. And he's saying we need to extend that to other people and in that way be a reflection of him. God's loved us with incredible love. We need to love others in the same way. So let's begin, and we're going to look at Luke chapter 6, and we're going to start with verse 27. But I say to you who hear, love your enemies, do good to those who hate you. Bless those who curse you, and pray for those who spitefully use you. To him who strikes you on the one cheek, offer the other also. And from him who takes away your cloak, do not withhold your tunic either. Give to everyone who asks of you, and from him who takes away your goods, do not ask them back. And just as you want men to do to you, so also you do to them likewise. These are some of what we call Jesus' hard sayings, because these things are hard for us to do. In the first part of the chapter, Jesus has expressed several woes to people, and those woes are bound up in the idea, if you treat people bad, I'm going to judge you for that, and I'm going to discipline you for that. So he's talked about those woes, and now he turns it around and says, we're going to talk about the right way to treat people. We're going to talk about the way I, the Lord, want you to treat other people. So he turns his attentions to his disciples and tells them that as believers, just like God has loved us, we need to love other people. We need to be an extension of God to other people. They need to see his love through the way that we treat them. When he says right there at the beginning, but I say to you who hear, the Hebrews, when they said the word hear, they were talking about more than just sound coming into our ears. They had the idea that you hear it, you understand it, and then you go out and obey it. So when he says, listen to this, or for those of you who hear, he's saying, I'm expecting you to do this. I'm expecting you to, in a sense, live out your salvation in the way that you treat other people. And this really goes back to the golden rule in Leviticus chapter 19. Leviticus 19, 18, you shall not take vengeance nor bear any grudge against the children of your people, but you shall love your neighbor as yourself. I am the Lord. So Judaism had always had this, but the problem was that by this time in the first century, the prevailing thought in Judaism was that your neighbor was the person who was just like you. They look like you. They dress like you. They are about the same socioeconomic level. They were certainly of the same race. And if you weren't a neighbor, if you weren't just like me, well, then it's okay not to treat you so well. Matter of fact, the Essenes, a fringe sect of Judaism, said this, you should love all the sons of light, meaning those within the group, and hate the sons of darkness. Well, that's not what Jesus is talking about, but that's the way Judaism looked at treating other people in the first century. We see that in the Good Samaritan, where the religious leaders passed on by and left the poor man to die, but then finally a Samaritan, somebody who was not like him, came by and took care of him, took care of his wounds, and helped him recover. And Jesus said, well, who was your neighbor? Well, it was that person who reached out in love and helped you. And so Jesus is saying, you need to show that kind of love to everyone. Jesus did that when he was on the cross. He prayed for the men who were crucifying him. Stephen did that when he was being stoned. As he was being stoned, he said, Father, forgive them. They don't understand. We see Paul doing that. We see Peter doing that in the New Testament. This is a radical challenge Jesus is putting before the people. It's radical for us to, in a sense, allow sometimes people to abuse us. It's so radical, so sacrificial, that you and I are not able to accomplish it. Only as the Holy Spirit of God indwells our spirit and empowers us to do this kind of love can that really happen. It's not a, when he says love one another, it's not that warm, fuzzy feeling we get around our wife or our children. It's a choice. It's an act of the will. Because I'm a believer, I'm going to choose to treat other people better. That's what he's trying to say. And he goes even beyond that, to petition God to bless those who are treating us poorly. What Jesus is trying to get them to say is that because God has showered us with such amazing grace and mercy and love, we need to be a reflection of him and show that kind of love and mercy to the world. One commentator put it this way: it's important to note that what Jesus said here was that people must know that God will be just and that he's displeased with activities that hurt others, for they reveal that one is out of touch with God. Interceding or praying to God for the opponent is one of the highest forms of love. Such love is a tough love, not because it requires harsh discipline against another, as parental love might, but because it requires submission of ourself to such a great degree that that submission is not normal for any human. It's a supernatural love, a love that can only happen as we depend on God. It means that at times we allow abuse. That's the, if he hits you on one cheek, then turn and give him the other one. That's hard for us. We all want to be like John Wayne or Liam Neeson and don't take anything off anybody. You hurt me, I'm going to hurt you worse. You come with a knife, I'm going to come with a gun. You know, that whole American individualist type attitude. That's exactly the opposite of what Jesus is saying here. He's saying that even if people mistreat us, we should continue to minister to them. But we go back to God. He accepted us. He loved us, knowing full well that we were going to sin again. We've all said, God, I'm sorry. Please forgive me of that sin. I'm not going to do that anymore. And before you know it, we're right back asking forgiveness for that same sin. And so the same way that God extends mercy and love to us, we're to extend that love and mercy to others. Now, it's important to understand that this is an individual challenge. This is not a governmental or even a church challenge. The church, the government, they have to exercise discipline at times. This is between me and you, me and another individual. So that's what Jesus is trying to get us to see about, because Paul says in several places that we're to be subject to the government, that we're to honor our authority, and that the government is here to protect us, and they're going to, and we're to let the government punish the evildoer. When they're talking about if someone strikes you on the cheek, it's in a religious context, and typically that was a backhand, and it was an insult. It was an abuse of power. It was an abuse of authority, and Jesus is saying, if they do that to you, give them the other one. Turn the other cheek. Let them have another shot at it. Because he loved us, he continues to forgive us, we should do the same thing. And then in verse 30, he says, give to anyone who asks. Luke may be using a little bit of hyperbole here, but the idea is the same, is that we are to always be ready to be generous and to help other people who are in legitimate need. Now, the hard thing is figuring out that legitimate need. You see a guy standing on the side of the road and he says, homeless, needs something to eat. Well, we don't know what decisions he made that put him there. However, I really believe we need to err on the side of generosity and leave the legitimacy of the need between that person and God. Doesn't mean we can help everybody, but when we can, we ought to always have that attitude. Even the verbs tell us that, because they're present tense verbs, which means that it's a continual action. That should be our attitude, and we should always be ready to help. When we take a $10 bill out of our pocket and give it to someone else, we're denying ourselves that $10 bill. And we're treating that other person better than we're treating ourselves. It's a perfect modeling of what Christ did for us. He sacrificed his life to purchase our redemption. One writer put, generosity is a concrete, fundamental expression of love. It shows them that we care for them, that we value them. Jesus is saying that our ethics, our moral compass, ought to be higher than the world's. When people look at us, they need to see his reflection and see his love and mercy toward them. In verse 31, they restate the golden rule. Again, Jesus is saying, just like you want to be treated, treat other people. But even really go beyond that. Treat other people the way God has treated us as believers. Let's look at verse 32. But if you love those who love you, what credit is it to you? For even sinners love those who love them. And if you do good to those who do good to you, what credit is that to you? For even sinners do the same. And if you lend to those from whom you hope to receive back, what credit is that to you? For even sinners lend to sinners to receive as much back. But love your enemies. Do good and lend, hoping for nothing in return, and your reward will be great, and you will be sons of the Most High. For he is kind to the unthankful and evil. Therefore, be merciful, just as your Father also is merciful. So Jesus begins to explain why we're to go that extra mile and to treat people that way. That idea of what credit is to you was a popular Greek phrase that basically meant, if I do a good deed that benefits you, I expect you to return that. You scratch my back, or you scratch my back, I'll scratch your back. That's the whole idea. And so Jesus is calling us to extraordinary goodness that we normally don't see around us. We're not to be like the world. We're to go beyond that. And so Jesus is telling us to treat people better than they deserve. And isn't that exactly how God has treated us? One of my favorite Psalms, Psalms 103, the Lord is merciful and gracious, slow to anger, abounding in mercy. He will not always strive with us, nor keep his anger forever. He's not dealt with us according to our sin, nor punished us according to our iniquities. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his mercy toward those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed our transgressions from us. Again, these are present verbs. Jesus is telling us in Luke, this is something we ought to do continually. This ought to be part of our life. In 35, we're promised rewards. It says, you'll be sons of the Most High. More literally, it will be that you'll be shown to be sons of the Most High. In other words, people will see us, see the way that we treat them, and realize that we're different, that there's something different about us. Hopefully, that'll give us a chance to share God with them. It's really showing the character and love of God to an unloving world. Verse 36 is very similar to Leviticus 19, where God says, you shall be holy, for I'm your God am holy. He says, be merciful because I am merciful. I've shown you mercy. You're to show it to other people. Look at verse 37. Judge not, and you shall not be judged. Condemn not, and you shall not be condemned. Forgive, and you'll be forgiven. Give, and it'll be given to you. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over, will be put into your bosom. For with the same measure that you use, it will be measured back to you. Now, this is not prohibiting legitimate concern and legitimate thinking about and exercising judgment. But what it does, really what it's talking about, is don't be critical. Don't be judgmental. We all know those people who never have something good to say about anybody. And as a believer, that should never be us. We ought to be quick to forgive, quick to extend mercy. It's not a matter of ignoring their guilt. Christ didn't ignore our guilt, but he forgave our guilt. And we ought to be the same way. One writer put it this way, what's commanditude is an attitude that is hesitant to condemn and quick to forgive. What's prohibited is an arrogance that reacts with hostility to the worldly and morally lax, viewing such people as beyond God's reach. In other words, it's just when we see somebody that's down on their luck or maybe somebody that's homeless, we don't immediately judge them thinking that we're superior to them. We understand they're a creation of God just like we're a creation of God, and we're willing to extend love and mercy to them. Verse 38, we get another promise. It says that with the measure that we measure with, that's how God's going to measure us. In other words, if we bless other people, if we're generous to other people, God's going to be generous to you. Now, I don't know about you, but when I look at my storehouse and I look at God's storehouse, I want to be blessed out of God's storehouse. My storehouse doesn't have that much in it. And so I want God to bless me. One Old Testament writer put it this way, the measuring of corn is a process which is carried out according to an established pattern. The seller crouches on the ground with a measure between his legs. He fills it 3/4 full and then gives it a good shake and shakes it around, making sure that everything presses down. Then he fills it the rest way up and presses it down, shakes it again. And then he rounds it up so that you get the full measure. You get every bit that you can in there. That's how God wants to bless us. Pressed down, shaken, overflowing. The Jewish rabbis often taught that God will judge us either with scales of justice or scales of mercy. I'm always going to want the scales of mercy. I don't want God to give me what I deserve, and that's the way we ought to treat other people. And when we obey Him in this area, it leads us to a more intimate relationship with Him, because we can be closer to Him when we're modeling and trying to live the way that He lives. God blesses us sometimes so we can bless other people. I have a great friend, and I've known him for about 30 years, and he and his father were exactly alike. They are some of the most generous people that I know. Back in the 50s, his dad was on the farm trying to raise his family, and he just couldn't make enough money. And so he went to town to find a job, and he found a job at an Amco station. And he worked there for a while, and then the man he was working for was crooked. And Amco came and took that franchise away from him. And they looked at him and they said, but we know you. We trust you. We want you to have this station. He said, I don't have any money for a franchise or anything like that. They says, we trust you. We'll work it out. So they gave him the station. He began to sell gas, began to do pretty well for himself. Well, his brothers and sisters were struggling also. So he began to buy the family farm back from them, not because he wanted the land, but because he wanted to help his brothers and sisters. As soon as he consolidated that farm, they found limestone on that farm. And he sold the limestone for I-75 to the government. that went on for years. They pulled hundreds and hundreds of tons of limestone, probably thousands of tons of limestone out of that pit. Environmentalist groups got together and they were afraid it was going to help the, it was going to mess up the environmental aspects of that area. And so the state bought it from him for several million dollars. It seemed like everything he did turned to money, but in everything he did, he blessed other people. And I really believe that's why God has blessed those men that way, because they were quick to help other people and quick to spread that blessing around. And I believe God will do the same for us. All the Gospels and the epistles really say the same thing. At the very heart of Jesus's teaching was love. If we love somebody, we're not going to do them wrong. If we love somebody, we're going to do the best we can for them, and we're going to look out for them even when other people don't. Again, it's not a feeling. It's a matter of our will. It's a choice that we make. God has extended us incredible love, incredible mercy. In 2021, we ought to make it our goal to extend that love and mercy to others. Thanks so much for joining us. Hope you'll be with us again next week.